365 News Station. I am your host, Alice, and today we'll be talking about the discovery of the mini moon, Oscars 2020, and the 52Hz whale. Our Earth is currently surrounded by roughly more than 23,000 artificial fragments larger than 4 inches orbiting our planet. This is called space debris. Space debris is anything that does not have a use anymore, but is still orbiting the Earth. About 500,000 more pieces between 0.4 inches and 4 inches are estimated to also be there as of April 2019. Recently, another item joined them. On February 15, 2020, scientists discovered a mini moon orbiting around Earth. We can't tell much about the object, including whether it is artificial or not. Most likely, it is a small asteroid around the size of a cow up to the size of a hippopotamus. The object, now named 2020 CD3, is very hard to see even on professional telescopes. Two research specialists were at the telescope, Cedar Prun and Casper Weirshoes. But it's a big deal, as out of roughly 1 million known asteroids, this is just the second asteroid known to orbit Earth. The first one was 2006 RH120, which was also found by the Catalina Sky Survey, says Weirshoes. When Catalina's observations looked a bit off and didn't match anything known by the other astronomers, they sent the information to the Minor Planet Center, where it was later confirmed. The object has likely been with us since 2017, but has gone unnoticed because of the vastness of the sky and how faint the object was to see. The co-discoverer says that it's what he calls a chaotic orbit. 2020 CD3 is currently torn between the gravity of the moon and the gravity of the Earth. 2020 CD3 varies between 0.2 lunar distances or 0.2 to 4.5 Earth center to moon center distances. Astronomers are yet to gather enough information to derive a light curve, a variation of light received over a period of time. When they do, it'll help to identify the object. Currently, the moon, the Earth, and the sun are all pulling on the object, making an irregular orbit. The object will likely leave orbit in April of this year. The Academy Awards, also known as the Oscars, are an annual award ceremony for outstanding artistic and technical skill in the industry. The five original branches of the awards include actors, directors, producers, technicians, and writers. The award itself stands at 13.5 inches tall and weighs 8.5 pounds. The award shows a knight holding a crusader's sword standing with a reel of film. This year, the 92nd Oscars took place on Sunday, February 9th. The movie Joker received the most nominations, with 11 nominations, while The Irishman, 1917, and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood followed up with 10 nominations each. The award shows a knight holding a crusader sword standing with a reel of film. This year, the 92nd Oscars took place on Sunday, February 9th. The movie Joker received the most nominations, with 11 nominations, while The Irishman, 1917, and Once Upon a Time in Hollywood followed up with 10 nominations each. The Oscars winner for this year for Best Picture, the largest award of the night, was for the film Parasite, directed by Bong Joon-ho. This year, Parasite was a big winner. Parasite had 6 nominations and received 4 of those awards. The movie became the first international feature film to win Best Picture. Until this win, only 10 non-English films have been nominated for it. Parasite, written by Bong Joon-ho and Han Jin-won, is a film about how greed and discrimination threaten the newly born symbiotic relationship between the wealthy Park family and the destitute Kim clan. Other major wins this year were Joaquin Phoenix for the leading role in Joker. Other major wins this year were for Joaquin Phoenix for his leading role in Joker, Renee Zellweger for her leading role in Judy, Brad Pitt for his supporting role in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and Laura Dern for her supporting role in Marriage Story. Best animated feature film of the year went to Toy Story 4, original screenplay to Parasite, and Rocketman won for the best original song was I'm Gonna Love Me Again by Elton John. Many more films have been and will be celebrated in the future. Don't miss out on the Oscars 2021. The blue whale is the largest animal to have lived on Earth. An average blue whale measures up to 70 to 90 feet, meaning a large blue whale could measure up to 2 standard school buses put together. One of them is especially known. In 1989, the US Navy had hydrophones in place to listen for Soviet submarines. They were also able to listen to whales, and when the Cold War started to see an end, they released the records to scientific researchers. In 1989, they also picked up a strange sound. The sound was similar to what they have heard of a whale song, however, in a much different frequency. The sound was similar to what they had heard of a whale song, however, in a much different frequency. The key notes of the song were sung in 52 hertz. The average frequency for a blue whale is between 10 to 40 hertz. The whale has the same migratory patterns as the blue whale, meaning it is likely at least part blue whale. The most agreed hypothesis is that the whale is a hybrid between the fin whale and the blue whale. Many today believe that the whale is perhaps the loneliest animal. A marine mammal researcher named Bill Watkins at the Woodhull Oceanographic Institution, who found interest in the recording, started a journey of research that was published in a paper a few months before his death in 2014 at age 78. It is perhaps difficult to accept that if this was a whale, that there could have been perhaps only one of its kind in the large oceanic expanse, Watkins wrote. Yet in spite of the comprehensive, careful monitoring year-round, only one call with these characteristics has been found anywhere, and there has only been one sound source each season. In 2013, a tabloid newspaper wrote about it, expressing that the whale is lonely and cannot find love because of its song. Overall, the whale appears to be healthy, perhaps even not as lonely as we thought. It was first recorded in 1989 and was last heard of at least of 2015. Even if it is not the loneliest animal, the whale has moved many people's hearts.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Max, and I will be talking about sports news around Canada and around the three major sports, MLB, NBA, and NHL. So starting with NHL. So last night, the Toronto Maple Leafs lost to the San Jose Sharks by a score of 5-2. Although it was a tough loss that snapped a three-game winning streak, a lot of good things happened too, as Austin Matthews scored his 46th goal of the year to close in on the scoring race within one goal, and the Rocket Richard Trophy. As well, he is on pace for 50 goals as his teammates grew mustaches to support his 50-goal season. And as well, Mitch Marner last night scored a phenomenal goal. He pulled the puck between his legs and fooled the defense and the goalie as he scored a beauty of a backhander that will probably be on play of the month, if not play of the year. And as well, 2 days ago, Leon Draisaitl of the Edmonton Oilers scored this 100-point season, and it's the second straight 100-point season that he's had. And now he currently has 107 points as he scored 5 points in the game yesterday, where he scored 4 goals and 1 assist. That is terrific, as he's the first one to score 4 goals this season. And last year, only one person scored four goals, which shows how rare it is. And now the Vancouver Canucks lost 2 days ago to the Columbus Blue Jackets with a tough loss of 5-3. They were up 3-1 until the third period, where they gave up 4 goals because of some defensive mistakes, and it was just unexplainable. The three-game losing streak was against the Ottawa Senators, the Toronto Maple Leafs, as well as the Columbus Blue Jackets. Tonight, they try to break that as they win. They try to win against Arizona. And 2 days ago, all the GMs around the league had a big meeting, and they were suggesting a rule change when it comes to offside rules, and which is about how if their skate is in the air across the blue line, it'll still count as no offside. And if that was the case this year, it would have counted as 14 more goals. And now I'll be moving on to NBA headlines. Yesterday, Caris LeVert scored a phenomenal 51-point game, as that's his career high. He scored 11 in overtime, which is every single point that the Brooklyn Nets scored, and they held the Boston Celtics within 2 points, with only 2 points in overtime. Both teams had a hard-fought game, but Brooklyn Nets survived to the end and won with Caris LeVert's help. The Milwaukee Bucks lost to the Miami Heat yesterday as they scored season-low 89 points. And Miami Heat scored 114 points. That's the biggest loss of the season, as well as the lowest points scored this season. And as well, yesterday the Toronto Raptors won against the Arizona Phoenix Suns by a score of 123-114. It was a great game by the Toronto Raptors despite the injuries of Marc Gasol, Serge Ibaka, and Fred VanVleet. They lacked a lot of centers, but they still came through with only one center and another person who plays power forward, who was a center that day. And now I will be moving on to the MLB news. So it's spring training time, and the Toronto Blue Jays are probably one of the league's one of the best teams in the league when it comes to the future, because they have a bunch of prospects who is waiting on deck to just become an MLB star as soon as they get called up. Like, for example, last year, Vladimir Guerrero Jr., who had a 98 home run performance in the home run derby. Bo Bichette, who broke so many doubles records, like most doubles in most doubles to start a career with 10, as well as most consecutive doubles with 9 with 8. As well, Kevin Biggio last year showed how he can do anything as he hit a hit for the psycho. He hit a triple, a double, and single, and a home run, which is a cycle, and that showed that he can run, he can hit gappers, and he can hit home runs, As this year, the top pitching prospect is on the Blue Jays once again. His name is Nate Pearson, as he was pitching 2 days ago, and that game was phenomenal to watch, especially when you see his pitches that hit 100 miles per hour. The sound when it hit the mitt was so crisp. I think everyone will be watching that clip over and over again who loves the sound of that. As well, he can throw nasty sliders with big movement that can slide across the strike zone at will. And he is just a phenomenal pitcher. And also yesterday, a big news was told that Christian Yelich reportedly has signed a 9-year, $215 million contract. Nobody knows if it's going to be an extension or a takeover of the contract that he has currently. It hasn't been confirmed by the club yet, but it is most likely to happen, as it was reported by Ken Rosenthal from The Athletics. Thank you guys so much, and see you guys next time.
新闻365，大家数一数，我是主持人 Jenny， 大家好。到现在，武汉肺炎已经三个多月了。今天我们要说一说的不是病毒，不是疫情，而是中国强大的基建艺术。在本次疫情中，中国再次神一样的出现了。为集中收治新型冠状病毒感染的肺炎患者，武汉火神山、雷神山医院相继投入施工。两座医院的计划工期都不到十天。除了在国内备受关注外，小汤山模式医院的建设也引起了国外媒体的关注。南非著名喜剧演员、脱口秀主持人 Trevor Noah 在他的节目《每日秀》中提到了此事。他为中国十天建成一座医院感到了震撼的同时，还吐槽起美国装个有线电视都没这么快。Travel 在节目中聊到此次新冠疫情，感叹中国十天就能建好一座医院。Travel 说道，中国政府正加班加点来阻止新冠病毒的传播。随后节目引用新闻片段指出，武汉工地现场的工人正与时间赛跑，要在十天内建造一座全新的有1000个床位的医院。当晚1900多万人在线观看火神山医院施工。武汉在建的火神山医院总建筑面积3.39万平方米，预计床位700到1000张，2月2日可整体移交解放军管理。和稍晚开工的雷神山医院一样，他们均是武汉应对新冠病毒的效仿非典时期的北京小汤山模式而加急建设的。此外，据国内多家媒体报道，较早开工的火神山医院可以说是一个小时一个样，一天可完成一栋双层病房区大建。超过1900万网友已在网上看到了医院的 高速建设似乎一直以来中国都有着基建狂魔的称号。根据福布斯杂志2018年的排名，全球十大建筑企业中中国就占六席。基建狂魔不是自夸，有很多的数据可以证明，公路2005至2017年中国高速公路新增700万多公里，预通车总里程达12.3万公里，位居世界第一，美国排第二为10.302万公里，加拿大第三为1.7万公里，紧随其后的是西班牙1.47万公里，德国1.297万公里，日本1.152万公里，法国1.146万公里，意大利0.672万公里，韩国0.57万公里，俄罗斯0.46万公里。铁路中国路里程为12万公里，世界排名第二。虽然中国铁路总里程与美国差距很大，但是中国高铁占优势。随着时间的推移，中国的高铁一条一条的逐渐开通，高铁规划的四纵四横已完成，八纵八横正在火热进行。高铁当今的现代文明主要是建立在钢铁和水泥之上。一个国家如果连钢铁、水泥都是不能生产，工业和发展经济便无从独起。但是基建又是一个国家的工业实力的体现。中国2017年钢铁总产量8.3亿吨，约占世界总产量的49%。日本和印度的钢铁产量在1吨左右。水泥，中国2017年生产了24吨水泥，约占世界总产量的58%。从水泥排行榜来看，全球主要国家水泥产量排名前十的国家，分别是中国、印度、美国、越南、土耳其、印度尼西亚、沙特、韩国、俄罗斯及埃及。技术在桥梁流传这样一句话：世界桥梁建设20世纪至90年代，以前看欧美，90年代看日本，21世纪看中国。目前世界上所有高难度创纪录的桥梁，大部分由中国创建。世界上已建成的最高5座桥梁全在中国。在已建成的或者在建的最高桥梁排名前20位国家和地区中，外国桥梁只在5座，中国则霸占了15座。那么接下来我们来说一说，为何中国基建产业如此发达。首先涉及到一个比较优势的问题，中国的人力成本相对来说比较便宜，而且人口红利的和第一产业人员溢出提供了大量的生产力。农民随着工业发展外出务工，比较突出的一个选择就是前往基建产业工作。这使得相对于其他国家，中国人在人力成本上是具有比较优势的。其次，中国广阔的市场提供了基础设施建造的巨大舞台，而基础的发展也反馈中国国家市场的扩大，并且支持经济的持续增长，从而也对基础缓出了更高的需求，成为一个正反馈。第三，从教育上看，中国培养了大批技术人才，从上世纪80年代的学好数理化走遍天下都不怕开始，中国大学教育对于培养工程师团队不遭余力。同时，广发证券的一份报告称，留学人员的回国是另一趋势。第四，中国政府支持以及国有企业体制和金融体制在某种意义上的支持，也有助于大型基建的发展。此外，中国人的吃苦精神也是一个重要原因。中国人具有很强的集体精神和组织能力，这是植根于文化传统的。中国历来是一个具有良好精神的国家，比如意大利，由于中国占领了大片的服装市场，中国人的吃苦精神让意大利人感到震惊，因此意大利人拍摄了一个纪录片叫做《不死的中国人》。当下一带一路沿线国家还有丰富的基建需求，并且可以完善基础设施 建设后发展更好的经济增长潜力，基建狂魔还有广阔的前途。让我们一起祝福基建狂魔魔性大发，为祖国加油！